Hi, this is Dr. Claire, and today we're going to be talking about selection. Selection is one of the mechanisms of evolution, and is probably the most well-known mechanism. The reason it's probably the most well-known is because it is probably the most powerful mechanism of evolution as well. It can cause, depending on the selective pressure on a population, it can cause very rapid change within a population over a very short period of time. It is also the only mechanism of evolution that actually leads to adaptation. And an adaptation is a trait that makes an organism more well-suited to its particular environment. And none of the other mechanisms of evolution that we discussed can lead to adaptation. Only selection can do that. So in order for selection to happen, there's a couple different traits of the population that you need to have. The population needs to have some sort of variation. That variation has to be heritable, so it has to have some sort of genetic component. And then there has to be some sort of difference in the reproductive success of some individuals with particular traits over others. So if we look at this little population of dots here, we have variation in the color of dots. Some of them are yellow, some of them are red, some of them are in between. There's some sort of genetic heritability of those that color. So individuals that are red tend to have offspring that are red, that kind of stuff. And then for some reason, red individuals in this population survive better than the yellow individuals. So the selective event occurs, most of the yellow individuals die, and then when the surviving red individuals reproduce, the subsequent population after their reproduction now has more of that red allele, and more of the individuals in that population are red. So evolution has happened, and presumably that red phenotype makes the individuals more fit, it makes them better able to survive in their environment, and so that red color would be an adaptation. Okay? All right, so there are actually a couple of different types of selection. There's natural selection. Natural selection is usually referring to traits that affect individual survival. There's also sexual selection. Sexual selection usually refers to traits that involve an individual's ability to obtain a mate. And then there's artificial selection. And artificial selection is derived from selective pressure that is created by humans. We are really, really good at artificially selecting organisms. We do this to domestic organisms all the time. So let's say you have a nice little woolly sheep. One of your particular sheep has really great wool, makes fantastic sweaters. And so you want to have more sheep that produce this wool. So you might take that sheep, breed it with another sheep with nice wool, and you are then creating a population of sheep that have this really nice woolly trait. So you are choosing who gets to reproduce, you choose who has high fitness, and so you put selective pressure on that population through your decisions. Okay, so that would be an example of artificial selection. All right, so let's take a look at how this actually affects the population. So selection always acts on the phenotype, not on the genotype of the individual. So if you have a trait that has one of those dominant recessive relationships where the heterozygote looks exactly the same as the homozygote, the selective pressure is going to act on the phenotype. So selective pressure is going to act exactly the same on a heterozygote as it will on a homozygote dominant. So let's take a look at this little example here. These are some peas. We have a gene for pea height, and there's two alleles. There is a tall allele and there is a short allele, and tall is dominant over short, so heterozygotes are also tall. Let's say for some reason the pollinator of these peas, some butterfly, doesn't like to go too close to the ground, so it doesn't pollinate the short individuals, okay? So short individuals don't get to breed, and they get removed from the population. Oops, there we go. All right, the heterozygotes, they're the same, right? So the heterozygotes and the homozygotes dominants have the same fitness. They both have the same chance of surviving and reproducing, whereas the short individual, the homozygote recessive, has lower fitness than the others, okay? So, and what I mean by fitness is the amount, their genetic contribution to the next generation. So the number of seeds, in the case of plants, that they leave behind, okay? So because these short plants have low fitness, they don't produce, in this case, in this particular example, they don't produce any offspring. And so the allele frequency in the population does change because we're removing those alleles from those homozygous recessive individuals. Now note, there are still short alleles in the population because the heterozygote individuals still contain those short alleles. So we haven't completely removed the short allele from the population, but we have changed the allele frequency. Before we removed the short individuals, the allele frequency was about 50-50. Now it's about 2/3 big for the tall allele and only 1/3 for the short allele. So that's changing the genetic frequency over time. So that would be evolution, right, happening right there. Okay, kind of makes sense? All right, so most traits that we might be interested in are not determined simply by one gene with two alleles. It's usually a heck of a lot more complicated. And so you normally have variation that is what we call quantitative versus qualitative. So rather than short P's and tall P's, where you have two qualitative categories, short and tall, if you were, say, looking at the human population, we have a variety of heights. You can be 4'11", you can be 6'3". There's a lot of variation there, and there's a lot of in-between variation. This is what we call quantitative variation. You can measure each individual. They have a number that's associated with that variation, and that variation is spread over a wide range. Now, most people kind of fall in the middle of that range. So this little illustration here is heights of people, or people organized by their height. And you can see that most people kind of fall in the middle, but there are some people at either extreme, right? So that'd be an example of quantitative variation. Okay, well, how does selection work on quantitative variation? Well, there are actually a couple of different ways that it can work on quantitative variation. So if you have this quantitative variation, so you have a wide range of individuals with various factors of a particular trait, you can have different types of selection on that. You can have what's called stabilizing selection. In stabilizing selection, the individuals who are in the middle, who have a medium trait, have higher fitness than individuals at either extreme. And so what that tends to do is it tends to drive selection towards that middle trait. This is pretty common. A lot of times there's a trait that's evolved over a long period of time, and that middle trait is actually the best because it's something that has had a lot of selective pressure, that's a good adaptation for its environment. If you go away from that, you tend to be less fit. You can also have directional selection. That's when individuals at one extreme have higher fitness than individuals at the other extreme. And that tends to drive evolutionary change in one particular direction. And then you can have disruptive selection. And that's where the individuals at either extreme have higher fitness than the individuals in the middle. And that tends to drive the population towards two different morphs. Okay, so let's take a look at some examples of this. So a really classic example of stabilizing selection is actually birth weight in humans. So as you may know, most humans that are born around 6 to 8 pounds in that general region. Around 7 pounds is the average. Okay, now if you are a baby who is born very, very large, your mother may have trouble delivering you, and that puts the baby at risk and also puts the mother at risk. And so babies who are very, very large have lower fitness because they have a higher probability of dying during birth. At the other end of the extreme, babies who are born early who are very, very small may not be fully developed and also have a high risk of death. And babies in the middle have the highest survival rates, so they have the highest fitness. That puts selective pressure on both the extremely large babies and the extremely small babies and drives the average birth weight towards the middle. Now with modern medical technology, we have ways to save these babies. Historically, a very large baby or a very small baby would have been very unlikely to survive. But now we have C-sections and we have NICU centers at the hospitals that help premature babies stay alive. So there's less selective pressure than there once was on this trait. Directional selection, this is when you have selection in one direction. One example of this is longhorn cattle. So this is a breed of cattle that exists in the southwest of the U.S. And the reason that we think that they have evolved these very, very long horns, in addition to probably some artificial selection for people who thought they looked cool and bred the longhorn cattle, was that having really long horns actually helped the female cows defend their calves from potential predators like coyotes, wolves, mountain lions, and other predators that were once common in the Southwest. So the female cows who had longer horns were better able to protect their young, and so then they had higher fitness than females with shorter horns. So you had that gradual change over time towards these very extremely long horns. Okay. Disruptive selection is actually relatively rare. It's not a pattern that we see a lot. One example is the black-bellied black-bellied seed cracker. These are an African species, and they live in an area where there's two predominant seed types. There are big seeds and there are small seeds. And if you have a big beak, you can pretty effectively eat the big seeds. If you have a smaller beak, you can pretty effectively eat the small seeds. If you have an in-between beak, there's not really much for you to eat. So there's actually selective pressure either to have big beaks or to have small beaks and not to have beaks in the middle. And so what you see when you look at populations of these seed crackers is that individuals either have big beaks or they have small beaks, and you don't see a lot of individuals with medium beaks because they've been selected against because they're not as efficient at eating these seeds. Okay? All right. So those are some types of selection on quantitative variation. Let's talk a little bit about sexual selection. Sexual selection is interesting because it affects the frequency of obtaining mates. So a lot of the time, sexual selection is going to act more strongly on males. And the reason it acts more strongly on males is basically because eggs are expensive and sperm are cheap. Okay, so if you are a female animal, even if you're a bird, if you're a mammal, and you're raising offspring, you can only raise a certain number of offspring at a time because you're limited by the amount of resources you have. So if you're a female bird, you only have enough resources to lay a certain number of eggs. If you're a female mammal, you can only gestate a certain number of embryos at the same time and only nurse a certain number of babies at the same time. And so you're limited not by how many individuals you mate with, but by the resources that you have available to raise those babies. All right? If you are a male of these species, you're not limited by resources. You're limited by the number of females that you can convince to mate with you. So if you're a male of these species and you mate with 7 female birds, that means you've got eggs in 7 different nests. Your fitness is very high. And so by mating with more females, you increase your fitness. A female, if she mates with 1 male, that fertilizes all of her eggs, she's good to go. If she mates with 7 males, she's still only going to lay 5 eggs. She can't lay more eggs just because she's mated with more males. All right. So sexual selection tends to act more strongly on the male because the male it has a greater fitness benefit for mating with more females, okay? So this tends to lead to sexual dimorphism because the sexual selection is acting more strongly on the male than the female. And the males who have particular phenotypes that allow them to get those extra mates are more successful, have higher fitness, and then their genes become more common in the population. So whenever you see a species where the males and the females look different, there's probably sexual selection going on, okay? Now there's 2 different main types of sexual selection. There's intrasexual selection. In intrasexual selection, males compete with each other for access to females. And when you have intrasexual selection, you tend to see males with either bigger body size that helps them to fight with each other, or what we call armaments. So things like antlers or horns or big aggressive claws or something like that. Something that's helping them fight with other males to get access to the females. Okay, so a couple of examples here This one over here, the seal, that's an elephant seal. That's an elephant seal male and an elephant seal female. As you can see, the males are much, much larger than the females. The way the elephant seal mating system works is that males compete for stretches of beach. And then the females come ashore to give birth to their pups. And after they give birth to their pups is when they are fertile. So the males get to mate with whichever females happen to give birth to pups on their stretch of beach. So they'll fight with each other to defend these stretches of beach. And the males, the bigger, stronger males who get to have a big piece of beach right in the middle of where the females are giving birth to pups, will get to mate with many more females than males out on the edges, okay? On the other side, we have some deer. Female deer tend to live in herds, and so a male deer will fight with other males to defend a herd of females, and then when those females become fertile, the male who is defending that herd will get to mate with all of those females, okay? So in both cases, the males are fighting with each other to get access to these groups of females. So where you have groups of females, you tend to see this type of sexual selection. You can also have intersexual selection, and intersexual selection occurs when females choose mates. So in this case, rather than the females not having a whole lot of choice, they just mate with whichever male is there, they actually will compare various males, assess their quality, and choose the male that has the highest quality. So that could be based on the resources that he has access to, that he can give her offspring, some sort of indication of his quality, his fitness, something like that. And so in these intersexual selection, you tend to see really elaborate, kind of silly male traits that are basically showing off how fit the male is. So the classic example is the peacock. The peacock's tail is really large, really elaborate, very expensive to produce. And so that indicates if a male can produce a big, showy tail, that indicates that he has access to lots of resources. And he's probably pretty strong and fast, because if you have a giant tail dangling out behind you and something tries to eat you, it's a lot easier for them to catch you, right? So he's got to be good at getting away from things as well if he can afford to have this really long tail. So that tells the female something about this is a high quality male who has good genes and access to a lot of resources. And so she'll choose that male based on that. So you probably heard of peacocks before. I'm going to show you something that's less common, a little video here. This is a bird of paradise.
This contender, called the superb bird of paradise, is a magician with a special trick. First, he advertises his show by calling to attract a female. And then, with the audience in place, he begins to work his magic. Now that's impressive, but she needs to step out for a moment to think. Oh boy, well, not today.
So that's another kind of extreme example. The birds of paradise, the males do these elaborate dances. There's actually a number of different species of birds of paradise. And other than the dancing to attract the female, they don't really help with reproduction at all. So the females have to build their nests, lay their eggs, raise the babies, and all the males do is dance. And so the females go around to the different males who are doing their dances, and they pick the male who does the best dance, because presumably the males who do the better dances have better genes to contribute to the offspring. Okay, so that's an example of intersexual selection. All right, those are our different types of selection. Catch you next time.